Praise the Lord. Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise with Jesus. Friends, a great and famous scientist was asked, "Do you believe in miracles?" Now, obviously, the scientist was asked this question because we all know that scientists lean heavily on their reasoning. And everything that happens is fitted within a scientific formula. So when he was asked that, it was definitely because they were expecting some kind of a reaction, because often faith contradicts reason in the mind of those who are heavily rational. But to the surprise of the one who asked the question, the scientist said, "Believe in miracles? Do I believe in miracles? I don't just believe in miracles. I live by miracles." Friends, I realize it is not enough for you and me to believe in miracles. You and I, we need to live by miracles. Every day, we need to move from one miracle to the next. And here is where I want to ask you, do you know what was the first miracle that happened for you today? Has any miracle happened yet? Well, I can answer for you and for myself. The first miracle that happened for us today was this: our eyes were opened. Yes, we have these two gorgeous eyes with which we have been opened to a whole new world, to a brand new day, and to all the beauty of this world. Consider what your eyes and my eyes have offered us. It is through these eyes that we have seen the glory of God, the beautiful patterns in the sky, the glory of God imprinted in all of creation, the unrepeatable patterns and designs on the trunks of the tree, on the leaves, on the flowers with its myriad shades and hues and patterns. Haven't we seen the glory of God and the beauty of creation? When someone smiles, I believe there is nothing else that can open us to the beauty of heaven as a genuine smile in the face of someone we love. A smile on the human face is a miracle, and our eyes open us out to many such miracles. It is through these eyes that we see the innocence in the eye of your pet dog, if you are an animal lover. It is through these eyes that we have been able to read and come to know the great findings and discoveries of humankind, the great journey of humankind. Well, friends, when we look at what our eyes have offered us, we realize indeed these two eyes are the great miracles that have opened us to so much that we can never stop thanking God. Yes, friends, we can never stop thanking God if we stop to think about the many miracles that our eyes have brought to us. Now, Scripture tells us that when we are not able to thank God enough for a blessing, there is something that we need to do. We need to consecrate that blessing to God. So when you and I realize that our eyes have been such a tremendous channel of God's blessings to us, we need to consecrate our eyes to God. So what does that mean? I need to use my eyes for the purpose that God has given it to me. God has given these eyes for His glory to be revealed and for His glory to be proclaimed. And that is why I need to ensure I am using my eyes for the right purpose. And this means I cannot afford to use these eyes to look to see the faults in others. I, on the other hand, need to use these eyes to look at humans with mercy, with goodwill, with hope, with patience, and with purity. So when we look at someone who is making too many mistakes, maybe their mistakes are hurting us, they're causing us grievous injury. When we look at such persons, how do we look with mercy? And here is where Place yourself in a position where you are looking at a two-year-old, say your own child or a nephew or a niece or someone you love. When a two-year-old is, you know, throwing tantrums, and they say two-year-olds are known as the terrible twos. They are at their worst behavior. Now, when they throw tantrums and behave miserably, what do? We laugh it off, and we are so sure that they would grow out of it. And so also, when someone behaves in a very miserable manner, no matter how much we are hurt, we need to look at them with that eye of generosity. We need to laugh it off and say, surely he or she will come out of this. And because of our mercy, because of our hope and our patience, and because of our goodwill, we will be agents of grace in that person's life, and we will aid them to grow out of that. Secondly, when we look at someone with impurity, now especially if you have ever gone into pornography, or you have looked at someone with lust, we need to think again. We don't owe this to anyone, and no one deserves to be looked on with lust, whatever their intentions may be. So when we look at anyone and we are tempted to look in an impure manner, place them as your own. What if this person was your own mother or father or brother or sister or son and daughter? If you think that is gross, think about it. Every human person is your brother and your sister. Yes, we are one family. We are one family, and God is our Father. And we cannot afford to look at any one of them in an impure way. Therefore, when we look at them as one of our own, we will not be able to see them in that ugly manner. Now, looking at someone with impurity doesn't just mean looking at them with a lustful intent, but when I look at anyone with a selfish intent, I look at someone and maybe I find in them a way by which I can manipulate them or use them for a personal benefit. I can do some injustice to them, or I am seeing them as a tool for my selfish purposes. I realize that is impure. I cannot afford to use anyone. I cannot afford to use any of my faculties to deceive anyone. And therefore, here, I need to place myself in that person's position. Would I like someone to exploit me, to manipulate me, to find a way of getting me to do what they want for their selfish purposes, to perhaps get them to pay my bills when I know it isn't exactly the right thing to do? When I know that I would not like to be treated or deceived in such a way or exploited in such a way, I will remember that is exactly the way I need to be looking at others. As Jesus said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Friends, when we begin to see every human person the way we would like others to see us, when we look at people as we would look at the ones we love, and we look at even those who fail with mercy and goodness, truly we will be giving a fitting thanksgiving for these two beautiful gifts of God, which is our eyes. Finally, Jesus tells us, your eye is a lamp of your body. And if your eye is in darkness, what a great darkness we would be living in. But on the other hand, if my eye is ablaze with mercy and purity and goodwill and hope and patience, we will be beacons of light, beacons of goodness, and we, along with all of creation, would reflect the glory of God. Friends, as we listen to this message, may we move forward to offer our eyes as an offering of thanksgiving to God. And as we conclude this program with a Eucharistic adoration, let that be a moment when we ask God for that grace to see everyone and the world and our lives as God sees it, with glory, with goodness, with thanksgiving.
Dear friends, a youngster with a shock of innocence visible on his face said to me, "You know, Father, God is so wise. God has given us two very precious organs, but God has also given us a door and lock and key for these two organs." I said, "What do you mean?" "You know, Father, the tongue and the eyes. The tongue can be closed and locked by the lips. The eyes can be closed by the eyelids." Because he said, "You know, Father, these two organs are so precious and useful, at the same time, could be very damaging. And therefore, God wants to use them only when we want them, as we want them, with a clear decision before using them." I thought about it. I said to myself, how wise a remark this youngster has made. The eyes God has given us are very precious. At the same time, eyes can be very damaging, even could destroy our whole life. And therefore, Job, in his wisdom, has said this. Book of Job, chapter 31, verse 1. "I have made a covenant with my eyes, and therefore I cannot look at a woman with evil in my eyes." I have made a covenant with my eyes. Covenant is a relationship. A relationship of love. A relationship between God and man. God enters into the life of man, revealing himself as love and giving a meaning and direction for the life of man. And man understanding how loving and caring God is, man surrenders his life totally in the hands of God and promises God that he will keep all the commandments. He will observe the will of God all the time, and God promises to protect and save man. That's a covenant. And covenant is so precious in the life of man that man allows his entire self to be integrated into that covenant relationship. All the aspects of his life, the way he looks at things, the way he says his words, the way he thinks his thoughts, the way he gets related to others, every aspect of human life to be integrated into the covenant relationship so that man is sure he's doing the right thing, doing God's will all the time. And that's why Job said, "I have made a covenant with my eyes." The covenant made to God becomes so all-inclusive. The eyes are integrated into that covenant relationship. And God does not want us to look at anything with sin in the eyes, with an evil purpose. Now, my dear friends, there's a difference between seeing and looking. We see things that come before our eyes. But then, before we look, looking is a purposeful decision. I look, I set my eyes. And before we look, we must make a decision whether the looking is according to God's will be integrated into my relationship with my God. There is a danger given to us from the beginning. In the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verse 6, how did sin enter into the world? How did devil have an opportunity in man to destroy him, to destroy her? Because Eve looked. Eve set her eyes on the fruit, forbidden fruit, and found it was a delight to the eyes. There started the downfall. And using the eyes with the wrong purpose can give opportunity to Satan to destroy us. Exactly what happened to David. David was a man of the covenant, always determined to please God. He knew he was chosen for a great purpose in life, though he was a mere shepherd boy. And David wanted always to do the will of God, but one look, one careless look, and later David laments, "My eyes, sin entered into my heart through my eyes," and that sin destroyed him. Adultery, murder, and all the evil consequences that sin brought into his life. A warning for all of us. How are we to use our eyes? How are we to look at things? The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 43, verse 11, tells us, "Look upon the rainbow and praise God who made it." See the beauty of God in the wonder of the rainbow. And Jesus said, Matthew chapter 6, verse 26, look at the birds of the air. Look at the lilies of the field and understand how great, how provident, how caring our God is. Our eyes are to be used to look around and see God's love, God's care, God's beauty, God's power everywhere. Therefore, our eyes are windows of the heart to perceive God's presence, God's love and care for us, so that our eyes lead us to God. God enters through the beauty and the wonder of creation into our hearts through our eyes. Eyes are so precious. As that youngster said in a shocking surprise, "Oh, how wise God is." And we must know this. To use our eyes only to perceive God's presence and God's beauty in the world around us.
When I look into your holiness, when I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you, when I find the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthroned in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you, I worship you. I worship you.
Jesus, let me begin this day looking into the holiness of your face. Before I look at the face of anyone else, before I look at the world around me, let me look at your face. You are the creator of the whole world. Everything comes from you. You created the whole world for us because you loved us. Everything came out of your love. And therefore, before I look at everything and anything, let me look at your face and worship you. I worship you, O Lord.
I worship you.
Above me, the green world around me, the rivers flowing, the birds chirping, all are created and given to me because you love me, Jesus. And my family is given to me by you, O Lord, and my friends, my teachers, and the people I'm going to work with today, everyone, the whole of humanity, O Lord, everyone is your creation, your gift to me. Let me look at everyone as your gift, your blessing you are giving me. And therefore, before I look at them, let me look at you and accept everyone from your hands as a gift you are giving me. And let me worship you and thank you for all my brothers and sisters around me. I worship you, O Lord.
I worship you.
I anticipate, as I begin this day, I anticipate it could happen that someone who looks at me could make me tense. Someone who talks to me could make me angry. Someone who deals with me could make me sad. Negative emotions could come to my mind during the course of this day, or something could lead me to a sinful desire. I could become greedy today, or some unholy desire could creep into my heart today. I want to look at your face, O God,
Your face is so holy, so pure, so beautiful. And therefore, before I look at anyone, before I look at anything, I want to look at your face, that I may be filled with your holiness. Jesus, let me look at your face. When I look at your face, O Lord.
When I look into your holiness, when I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you. When I find the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthroned in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you,
I worship you, Lord Jesus. I worship you, Jesus.
The reason I live is to worship you.
This day,
I worship you.
The reason I live this day is to worship you. Jesus.
To worship you. And the reason I live is to worship you. Hallelujah, we pray.
Jesus, you asked me to look at the lilies of the field, how beautiful they are. Not even Solomon, in all his glory, was arrayed like one of them. Jesus, you asked me to look at the beauty of the lilies of the field. And know this, if the Heavenly Father clothes them so beautifully, how much more will not your Heavenly Father clothe you? And therefore, the beauty of the lilies of the field teaches me the lesson. My Abba, my Heavenly Father, cares for me. Jesus, you ask me again, hear the birds singing. How beautiful they sing, how free they are. They fly around. And your Heavenly Father cares for them. Not one of them falls to the ground without the knowledge of the Heavenly Father. Jesus, you tell me, if your Heavenly Father cares for each one of those birds of the air, how much more does not your Father care for me? Every one of those birds should teach me the lesson that Abba, the Heavenly Father, cares for me. The whole universe teaches me the lesson of my Father's, my God's, my Heavenly Father's tender care for me. Lord, teach me to look around and see the face of your Heavenly Father, the loving providence of your Father who cares for me. Let me never get upset. Let me never become anxious today. Lord, all the talk of the pandemic could make me anxious today. And all the bad news of the coronavirus spreading all over could make me upset today. The people coming to me telling me of everything going wrong around me, about people losing jobs, could make me upset today. And yet, I need to believe. Your Heavenly Father, my Heavenly Father, the Heavenly Father whom you want me to call my Abba, my Father, cares for me. Looking around this marvelous, magnificent universe, I need to believe in the love of my Abba. Lord, I worship you. I worship Abba, my Father. I worship the Holy Spirit. I worship you, O Lord.
I worship you. I worship you. The reason I live is to worship you. I worship you,
Jesus. Abba, Father, Holy Spirit. The whole day I will think of you. I will worship you. I will live in peace and joy and love. I will breathe the air of peace, worshiping you and thanking you, because you are my God. You love me. Everything whispers to my heart of your loving care for me. Lord, thank you.
Thank you, Jesus,
for speaking to me of your great love. Thank you for telling me how this universe, this magnificent universe around me, whispers to me of your love. Thank you, O God.
Thank you,
this day, this day, I accept from your hands as your gift. Your word tells me, Psalm 118, verse 24. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad. Lord, this day is made by you and given to me as a gift from your hands. My dear sisters and brothers, last night, the early hours of last night, I was praying for some time. I was studying. I was reading the Word of God. All those hours, I could hear the sirens of the ambulance. Ambulances rushing along the highway by the side of the retreat center. Every time I thought it should be a sick person being rushed to the hospital nearby, but it could be an accident case rushed to the emergency ward or to the intensive care unit. I do not know how many of them are still alive and how many of them are dead by now. If that happened in a little town here, thousands, tens of thousands would have lost their lives last night. They did not have the privilege to open their eyes this morning. When I opened my eyes this morning, the first thing I said was, Lord, thank you. You gave me this day. This day is a privilege. This day is a gift. This day is a grace you have given me. A grace not given to tens of thousands of people for your own reason, but you considered me precious, that you gave me this grace My dear sisters and brothers, the Lord has given us this gift, this blessing of this day. The Lord has prepared this day and given this blessing for us. Let us accept this blessing from the hands of God. Let's sing together, praising and thanking God, rejoicing, accepting this gift from the hands of our God.
This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice in the Lord.
Rejoice
in the Lord.
Lord.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice.
I rejoice
in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord.
Lord, every moment of this day is planned by you. And nothing will happen to me by chance. Every moment of this day is planned by you. And all that I need to do is to fall in line with your plan. And your plan is for my good, for the welfare of my family. I need to wait praying, asking you, oh God, what is your plan for me? And I shall not allow any evil desire to enter into my heart. I shall not allow any bitter, angry thought to come to my mind. I shall not allow any lustful desire to creep into my mind. I shall keep my heart pure and open to you. And I will be able to discern your will. What I am to do today, Lord, this day I accept from your hands. This is the day.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. Rejoice in the Lord.
I rejoice, my Lord.
Rejoice.
I thank you, my Lord.
Lord,
give me your spirit. It is in the light of your spirit that I will know your will. It is in the power of your spirit that I will be able to be holy today. I will be able to do your will today, not my will. Lord, not my will, but your will be done. And I shall keep my heart always transparent, waiting for your will, your face, to shine in my heart. Let me be able to experience your face, your will. Lord, let your anointing of your spirit come into my heart at every moment of this day. Anoint me with your spirit and give me your blessing, O Lord.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving.